multi-component KPC equations. We heard a lot about KPC equations. I'm enjoying this term already. And multi-component actually means here something very, very simple. So it's still KPC equation in one dimension, but rather than looking at the scalar equation, I'm going to look at the vector valued equation. All right. That looks like a natural generalization, but nevertheless, I will spend quite a bit of time to explain why I'm actually interested in this case. And then I will tell you a little bit about what we know about this equation. Of course, you know, it's something which is fairly recent, and so compared to the scalar equation, sort of the knowledge is basically down to zero, but nevertheless, there's some interesting information. Okay? So the way I want to start with is the story of the long time tails, sort of a famous story of statistical mechanics. And so that will serve as the motivation. So I start, let's say, with a classical fluid, sort of just particles moving in d-dimensional space and interacting with a short-range potential. So here's your Hamiltonian. And of course, what people have done, I mean, many years back, is looking at the equilibrium measure. So here it's our Gibbs measure. And sort of in the 60s and 70s, doing cluster expansions and such type of techniques, one can prove that if I look at the static correlations, they simply decay exponentially. All right. Now, of course, you might want to look at not just the static, but you also might want to look at what I call equilibrium time correlations. And what this means is I just have some observable, which I just denote here by sort of globally by A, at time t, and I correlate it maybe with some other observable at time t equals zero. Of course, this time evolution is generated by the Hamiltonian, and the average is simply the thermal equilibrium average according to this distribution. Okay? Now, typically, I want to sort of look at local observables, so you know, I should put here sort of like an index, which indicates at which point I'm looking, but it's easier in this drawing. So here I have maybe sort of my observable B, which is maybe sort of concentrated near the origin, and then I want to look at its correlation with the observable A at time t. And maybe one way, I mean, the way I'm talking about this mostly is that I'm thinking that I sort of insert, you know, I have this equilibrium system prepared, and then I insert a small perturbation at time t equals zero at the origin, and then I want to sort of see how it's propagating in time, and that's sort of measured through this other observable A, which could be the same as B, actually, right? I mean, so that's
so
sort of...
Well,
according to Hamiltonian's equations of motion, perfectly deterministic, Newton's equation of motion. Yeah. Deterministic evolution, all the time will be deterministic. I mean, for that part will be deterministic. Okay, now what will it look like? Well, of course, if I fix time t and if I go for large x, it will still decay exponentially because it's sort of basically local dynamics. And so whatever you have, you know, it just cannot propagate too fast. So if I fix time, it will decay exponentially. On the other side, if I'm, let's say, seeking at the origin and sort of see how sort of things are decaying in time, well, I mean, there will be conservation laws, and that conservation laws will tell you that it cannot just sort of decay sort of arbitrarily fast. And what you know sort of from basic physics, what you would expect that in time I should see a diffusive behavior, okay? Maybe not, but that's sort of the most common thing. And if you open the textbook, I mean, that's sort of what they would tell you. Of course, the picture is more complicated, obviously, but that's sort of the zeroth order approximation. So let me take sort of one very concrete example for such a correlation, which physicists are very much interested and study very heavily because it tells you sort of gives you information about this diffusive transport. That's what's usually called the total energy current correlation function. So you look at currents, they are, in terms of this inner product, they're actually orthogonal to the conserved quantity. So in principle, they could decay very fast. I mean, so they are certainly, you know, they do not actually see anything of this diffusive behavior. And once you know, and I'm looking at what people call the total, it just means that I'm not looking at the current at one given site, but I'm summing over all sites, right? I mean, so total means basically that this one, you could think of the energy current at the origin, but the one at time t, I'm simply integrating over all spatial arguments. This is what is meant by total, okay? And of course, you know, at any fixed time, I mean, this spatial integral will be well-defined because you have exponential decay in x, all right? And so now you want to study this quantity, and well,
can you just define the current,
Well, I mean, I leave it sort of slightly symbolic because I'm not going to use it very much. But I mean, you know, since you have the conservation laws, I mean, they are local, essentially local conservation laws, and from this we can deduce what is your expression for the energy carbon. That's another observable. I mean, and okay. No.
I'm confused about this too, to be honest.
I'm confused about this too. Conservation laws, you know. And
these are local conservation laws.
Yeah, I don't know what you mean.
So can you
okay. So let me. If I forget the potential term, if I only take the kinetic term. Well, of course, you can also add the potential. Yeah, I mean. That's right. No, but you can write down these things. It's written in the books. I just don't want to do it because you know that's sort of.
All right.
Okay. All right. So now I want to come to this long time tail business. I mean, so one is looking at this energy. Total energy carbon correlation in equilibrium. And the question is, can you compute anything? And the answer is, of course, you cannot because it's a complicated system. But what you can do and what people have done is you can look at sufficiently low density, and then this carbon correlation function can be computed by actually analyzing the nonlinear Boltzmann equation linearized at thermal equilibrium. That's a well-defined nice sort of self-adjoint operator. You can look at the spectrum for the usual type of interactions like hard spheres or any short-range potential. You find that this operator has a spectral gap, and therefore you conclude on the level of the kinetic theory, you do find exponential decay of carbon-carbon correlations, which sort of is okay. I mean, it's sort of like saying that you have a Brownian particle, then, you know, of course, its position will be sort of diffusive, but then when you look at the velocity, it will have short-range correlations, and you know, sort of for most sort of simple models which you do for the velocity, you will have actually exponentially decaying correlations. All right? So this was sort of the general belief. I mean, you know, for many years, all the way up to the early 70s, where there was a famous work of Alder and Wainwright, who said, well, I mean, that's fine with this prediction, but let's see what's actually coming out. And you know, this was the time when they could use computers, and so these were sort of small systems, like maybe 400 or 500. Maybe 200 disks, so two dimensions, and they sort of studied this thing. And what they found on the computer was that it does not decay exponentially, and that sort of was then coined as long-time tails. And of course, once they found it, I mean, and they gave already some explanations. When they found it, I mean, there was sort of theory behind it, and eventually the claim was that these carbon-carbon correlation functions should decay, I mean, with a lot of provisos, but you know, the first approximation should decay like e to the minus c over 2, where d is the dimension of the system. Okay? And you should think of these logarithms like a return probability. As you put this perturbation, there are sort of hydrodynamic currents generated in the system, which sort of push this correlation. And this pushing sort of gives you sort of a slow decay, as indicated here. Okay? Now, for three dimensions, that's not too much of a trouble because it's still an integrable thing. And so you still get finite diffusivity. And so from this, you would conclude that energy is sort of propagating diffusively. But and you see that the two sort of seems to be sort of like a marginal dimension. But if you go to one dimension, then you get t to the minus 1/2. And so you see that in one dimension, you expect on the level of this very simple argument, super diffusive transport. Okay? Now this was sort of standing like this. I mean, you know, physicists were not terribly much interested in one dimension. I mean, sort of they were more interested in three dimensions and maybe to some extent in the marginal dimension because you can do more easily the numerical experiments. In any case, I mean, so this was sort of sitting there for a long time. And somehow in early 2000, I mean, people for various reasons became interested in actually also the one-dimensional case. And so what they did was sort of, I call this MD. I mean, this stands for molecular, I guess I put it over here already. I mean, that stands for molecular dynamics. Just means that I'm integrating the deterministic equations of motion. That's all what it means, right? And so the system what Grasberger and his company looked at was actually a hard point gas of alternating masses. So you are now in one dimension. You imagine that you have point particles and they undergo elastic collisions. Now, if you have the same mass, then of course, you know, it's an ideal gas. I mean, there's just relabeling of particles and nothing very interesting happens. So what, in order to beat the case, I mean, what they proposed in this paper, which I think was a very nice proposal, is that let's look at the hard point gas where the masses are alternating. So you have mass 1 and then mass 3, mass 1, mass 3, et cetera. Okay? But they're alternating. And since they are hard points, I mean, this order is never, I mean, is maintained. Okay? So the neighboring particles which collide have different masses, and this gives you a non-trivial collision, a non-trivial transformation with sort of incoming and outgoing velocities. And the hope would be that this is sufficiently chaotic, so you see there's sort of, you know, canonical long-time behavior, which is always based on the idea that the dynamic sort of, you know, doesn't have extra conservation laws, is sufficiently chaotic, and so you really get sort of deterministic chaos, which provides the source for this type of decay. Okay? And what he found is in sort of fairly precise computations, he found that in fact in one dimension, this energy carbon-carbon correlation function doesn't decay like this sort of very naive prediction one half, but he found a decay like 2^-2/3. And then, of course, it requires sort of very little sort of insight into the subject that you say maybe this has something to do with KPC. Okay? But that's all. I mean, there was no further explanation. It was just sort of the observation that this exponent fits with the KPC. All right. Now, let's see. What did I else prepare here? Okay. So what I propose is that one should re-examine the one-dimensional case. And this is what I'm trying to explain you how far we got in this. Well, I mean, I guess, you know, you have a freedom of how to choose the mass ratio. And the way how people, I mean, they have.
Exponent depends on.
Oh, no, in principle not. But you see, it's sort of more numerical observation if they do it a ratio like, or golden ratio or something. If they do it sort of a ratio like this, I mean, then sort of the numeric sort of, you can more easily see the computation. If you do it, you know, very close to 1, right, 1 and 1.1, I mean, then, you know, sort of for a very long time, the system doesn't look so nice and then. So it's more like a numerical observation. I don't think there's any deep reason behind that. I mean.
So you just want to break the integrability.
Yeah, you want to break the integrability. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, one would hope, right? I mean, you know, one has. I mean, sort of. I guess numerical people sort of, you know, they fix one value and then the next one sort of likes to take the same value because, you know, then he can more easily compare, right? I mean, so that's the way how it works. Okay. All right. So why I want to re-examine the 1D case? Well, first of all, there are by now very, very many large-scale sort of molecular dynamics simulations available, and I think it's simply a challenge to the theory to say something sort of more clever than just sort of noting that, you know, I mean, they're the same exponents, okay? So that's sort of my personal motivation. And the second motivation is something which is sort of, you know, much more sort of like a hope, and it's not clear, you know, how much it will go. Is of course, eventually you would like to do the same type of thing for 1D quantum systems, and since we are looking at the hydrodynamic theory, you know, I mean, all what matters are the conservation laws. I mean, whether it's classical or quantum is sort of presumably sort of a second order. And of course, I mean, there's sort of huge interest in this type of questions. I mean, usually this goes under sort of the heading of homogeneous quantum quenches. And if you want to really study the long-time behavior, then you sort of should link up to the type of theory which I'm describing. Now this is, of course, and of course there's the point that you can use cold atoms sort of as analog computers, so there's some hope of actually sort of you know, having some sort of check of what your theory predicts. So this I can't go into. I just want to recommend there sort of, just recently, 2 weeks ago, Achim Roche sort of put a little letter on the archive and he emphasizes the issue of long-time tails and the connection with quantum quenches. And sort of discusses also a little bit connection to KPC. And anyway, I mean, if you want to sort of get an idea, you know, how many people are working in this area, I mean, just look at this paper here. Now, what I want to do is I want to sort of, as I said, I want to do the underpinning over here. I mean, I want to re-examine the 1D classical case. And the method which I'm going to use and which I want to explain, I mean, during this talk here is what is called, what I call, or what is usually called, nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics. Okay, so it's certainly not a microscopic theory, but there will be microscopic input. Okay, and of course, eventually we would like to really make prediction which we compare with the simulations. Okay, so the idea is that we have nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics, and so I have to first look at how many conserved fields we have. So for these fluids, I mean, typically would we have 3 fields, maybe. Other systems have sort of typically like two conserved quantities. And so, in order to explain what the method is, it's easier to abstract from the specific case. So I will first look at the case of n conserved fields. And then later on, you know, I will look at sort of special cases where n happens to be 2 or 3. I mean, there's sort of no real good example where you go beyond 3.
I want to ask you about this homogeneous quantum quench.
Yes. Well, so homogeneous means that you start with a translation invariant state, okay? But it's a non-equilibrium, it will evolve under your Hamiltonian, okay?
Yeah.
And then what people are simply asking, you just watch the system and you wait and see what happens, right? And of course, what happens at a very, very long time is you would hope that you sort of see thermal equilibrium. Oh, yeah, that's an interacting quantum system. Yeah, you could think of a Hubbard chain, but non-integrable. I guess typically. That's right. I mean, so it's the same thing as in the classical case. I mean, people do a lot of work on integrable system, which of course will behave sort of more complicated. But then the hope is that when you go to the non-integrable case, you get something. Okay. And so I guess.
The suggestion is you will not get sort of a diffusive behavior in this case. You'll get something.
Well, you have to. Yeah, but okay. I mean. Okay, you know, one has to really look case by case, but certainly there's also the possibility that you will get sort of super diffusive transport, right? I mean, under some condition, I'm not saying that every non-integrable, I have to look at the conservation laws. I mean, typically you need momentum conservation, which sort of, it's not so obvious, right? I mean, if you put it on the lattice, I mean, that's broken. And okay, it's a story by itself, right? I mean, so all what I'm saying is, I mean, this is sort of speak in view, I mean, okay? But it's the same, it's basically the same idea. I mean, you want to, you start in a spatially homogeneous case, you want to look at, sort of the V long time behavior, then eventually you would hope that there should be some sort of hydrodynamic sort of macroscopic type theory which would take over. Okay? But, it has to be studied. I mean, I'm not saying that this is in any sense a closed chapter, but huge number of, yes. Well, good question, yes, sure, yeah, good question. I don't know, I mean, that's, sure.
Why is it important if you have multiple conservation laws?
Well, I mean, first of all, it's a mere fact that, if you look at the mechanical model, there will be typically energy, momentum, and mass, so typically we'll have multiple conservation laws. It's very difficult to write down a mechanical system which has only one conservation law, okay? And the other point which I'm trying to make is that if you really want to understand sort of, systems with several conservation laws, you really have to understand how they interact on this nonlinear level. And it will really make a big difference between various systems of how the interaction is. So the interaction will be actually between these locally conserved fields. Okay, so you will see how this comes up. Okay, so let me sort of continue. So now I'm just abstracting from the specific system. I'm just sort of explaining you a little bit this method of nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics, which is extremely simple and straightforward, right? I mean, so there are other cases, other things which are more complicated, but this one is sort of very simple. And so I start with this, just in order to have the mathematics, I just start with a single component. So now n is equal to 1. And here I'm just writing down this sort of stochastic conservation law. So U is my field. And of course, I have a nonlinear covariant here. I have a nonlinear sort of diffusion term. And I add it by hand, space-time white noise, with a strength which also depends on the local value of my field. Right? I mean, so that's just sort of the standard setup. I mean, if you forget about this one, which would be just sort of the usual deterministic conservation law, now I added dissipation and noise. And well, U would be, for instance, the density, but then I have also to look at the other fields. But think of the U as a density, right? I mean, okay. And then, in principle, so it's a stochastic partial differential equation. So in principle, I want to look at the stationary process, and so I will fix it in such a way that the background, I mean, the average of U is equal to U naught, and this is sort of like this is sort of like the equilibrium parameter. That's sort of the background field. And I will keep it a little bit, but eventually, I mean, the U naught will sort of disappear from my notation because it would become too clumsy. Okay, so I have this average. So this is sort of simply the average value. And of course, the U zero is sort of a one parameter family because I have a conservation law, and therefore I can sort of by conservation law I can change this average as I wish, and I simply fix it to be one particular value. Okay, well then there will be the covariance in this equilibrium measure, and I'm assuming. Because that's sort of what we get from most of the microscopic models. I'm assuming here, and which in principle should be a consequence of this equation, that it's at equal time, it's short-range correlated. I mean, so the delta you should not take absolutely serious at the moment, but I mean, let's sort of say that it's something like this. And then You know, there will be sort of like fluctuation dissipation theorem, which again, I mean, something which should be discussed. But I mean, nevertheless, I just want to emphasize that there's a relationship between, if you just, okay, maybe one way to say this, if I put this equal to zero and you look at the invariant measure for this Gaussian process, I mean, then you will see that this coefficient is related to the other coefficients exactly in this way, right? I mean, so that's just sort of an element of the Gaussian theory. And now, of course, it's a complicated system. So one way to simplify is to say, well, you know, we have this background density. Why don't I simply expand around the background density, okay? So the U tilde is written as the background plus a small perturbation. And now I simply go ahead and expand this equation, okay? Now, of course, if I just expand to linear order, I will get the Gaussian theory, which I can solve, but which makes the wrong prediction. So that's certainly not a good idea. And therefore, you know, the simple observation is that you should expand at least to second order. And if you start going to higher orders, I mean, just by simple power counting, you realize that these terms are irrelevant. I mean, they just sort of scale differently and scale down to zero. And so the only terms which I keep at that level is the U squared term. And similarly, if I look at the dependence of the D and the B, I realize that, you know, any further powers which I would add here would simply be irrelevant also. And therefore, these are simply, the B is will be now just simply fixed. It's just one given number and the D equally. Okay?
How do you know they're irrelevant?
Well, power counting. I mean, at that stage, it's just totally naive power counting. And each one of these things could be questioned. And okay, but I mean, yeah, I'm just doing the most simplest thing here. But it's clear from power counting that you have to keep the U squared term, right? All right, and then, of course, I'm already sort of done. I mean, here I've written now sort of, I mean, this J double prime is the current, the derivative of the current evaluated at the background density. So this is just a number. That's also a number. All these things are numbers here.
When you say you're doing power counting, you're just keeping the first non-trivial
non-linearity. Yeah. Yeah, that's all what I'm saying. And of course, it could happen that you know, the J double prime happens to be zero, then I have to sort of redo my exercise. Okay. All right, and so this is, of course, the equation which we know. I mean, that's the KPC equation or stochastic Burgers equation. You can verify that you know, spatial white noise is actually the stationary measure for this case. It's a well-defined object. And so on this, we sort of know, you know, from my perspective at the moment, we sort of speak know everything. In particular, what we know is that if I look at the UU correlation, which is sort of physically somehow the most important one, that for long times and large x, it will be of scaling form. There's this universal scaling function KPC, and then there's a non-universal factor, which, so there's the C in front of it, and here's a non-universal factor, which is sort of in these units here, is just given by, is proportional to the second derivative, and which is proportional to the strength of the non-linearity. Okay? So this is the object which we have seen many times on the board, right?
For me, the connection between the initial model and this equation remains pretty mysterious. For example, I don't know where this white noise, stochastic noise, comes from.
It's a model. I mean, you know, I mean, it comes from deterministic chaos. No. I mean, well, as you will see in the examples, I'm will making the cross connection. You know, it's sort of like doing fluid dynamics. You also don't solve Newton's equation of motion. You use the Euler equations, right? I mean, you know, that's the same thing here. I mean, well, sure. I mean, that's the problem. But you know, that's just I cannot help it with it. I mean, because we don't understand it. I mean, no. I mean, it's clear that you would like to link. You know, would have a much more precise link between sort of the mechanical model I've sort of haven't really written down, but which I have in mind in this type of theory, but we don't know. Okay, so I just.
The noise is generated by the non-linearity.
I mean, the noise is just it's just deterministic chaos. I mean, it's generated by the non-linearity. That's at least sort of the generic belief, which I think is actually quite correct. Could be also numerical noise in a simulation, but I think what we really believe in, it's sort of, okay. Anyway, so I just want to point out two sort of some rules. One of them, if I do the integral over x, because u is conserved, I mean, the time goes out, and that's just sort of the integral over the static pair correlation function, which I called c. And if I look at the first moment, again, by conservation, you see that it goes exactly linearly with t and has sort of this particular prefactor. Okay? Okay, so now we have done the known case, and now I will come to the several component case, and sort of it's sort of more or less obvious, right? I mean, what I have said is wherever you saw a scalar, you replace it by a vector, and wherever you saw a capital letter, you replace it by a matrix, okay? Now, so again, we do the power counting. I mean, so here is the original system in full generality. So now the D is, of course, an n by n matrix. I mean, you know, for every component, I will have a particular current. And what I want to, maybe in order to answer at least partially your question, for instance, this current is taken from the microscopic model. I mean, this is something which I compute from the microscopic model. So it's not just the arbitrary current. It's the one which I compute from a particular model. But of course, other things I don't know how to compute. I have no idea how to get the white noise from the microscopic model. That's a much more difficult question. But some input is actually there. OK, and so now you do this same power counting. Of course, there's very little difference. I go to second order. So you will have the linear term, and you will have the Hessian, which is, of course, quadratic in this U fields. And then you have dissipation, and you have noise. Okay, and if you want to sort of know what the U's are, so you can think of U1 as the density, U2 the momentum, and U3 equal to the energy density. Okay, it's just a system with three conserved quantities. Okay. So what I'm saying is that what did for single conservation, I'm now just doing for n conservation laws. Okay, and again, you know, if I just look at the Gaussian theory, I mean, so I drop this term here. There will be a fluctuation dissipation theorem, which tells you that I should think of this dB, I mean, actually not unrelated, but related to the static covariance. And I emphasize again, I mean, the C would be an input from the underlying model. I mean, I'm assuming that there's an underlying model for which I can actually compute what the stationary measures are. For instance, you know, the usual Gibbs measures, and for which I can compute what is the covariance. I mean, the susceptibility matrix. I mean, that's something which is sort of known. And then you look at this thing, and in fact, there are sort of two thumb rules again. I mean, first of all, there's I use sort of conservation stationarity. So first of all, if I integrate over all x, I will get back this susceptibility matrix. I mean, so that's one important thumb rule. And the second one is I can also look at the linear moment, and what you find is that it grows linearly in time with this particular prefactor. And if you do sort of, if you use the stationarity, then you discover that there's actually a relationship between A is the linear-wise equation. I mean, that's the linear term, okay? And the static susceptibility matrix. Now, why is this an important relation? Well, it's important because, you see, at that level of generality, the A could be more or less anything. It could be completely crazy matrix. But now I'm telling you that this actually, you know, if I multiply it with C, and C we know is a nice, positive, definite matrix, no zero eigenvalues. If you conjugate it, I mean, if you multiply it with C, then it's actually sort of a symmetric matrix. And so this tells you that the A actually cannot be too crazy. And that's what I'm going to next. For instance, at that level, you could say, you know, what are the eigenvalues of A? And they could be more or less anything. But here, from this relation, you understand that they have to be actually real. Okay? Yes?
So you know that the invariant measure is...
No, of course not. I mean, I'm coming to this. No, I don't know. But I'm just saying that I just want to emphasize, this is a very general relation which holds also for mechanical systems. I mean, it's actually important for this analysis.
Sorry.
Well, I mean, no, okay, I guess what Jeremy is asking is, I mean, take this equation very serious, do I know the invariant measures? And the answer is no, right? I mean, now, of course, the microscopic model, I'm always assuming, I mean, from...
Is that the definition of the C then?
Hmm?
The C before was...
No, I'm just saying that there is sort of an input from the microscopic model which has to be reproduced, right? And so somehow I always assume that the C is sort of known, right? I mean,
so...
hmm? No, partially. Okay, so let me explain this again. So one thing is you could just look at this equation by itself, and you could ask yourself, you know, is there a stationary measure, and what is sort of the C matrix of this stationary measure? This, of course, I don't know how to answer. At least I can answer only very partially. The second point is that I can say, okay, look, I mean, I have for my microscopic model, I have also, you know, also for if this would be the microscopic fields, you will have exactly the same type of relations, right? And then you would say, you know, this is something which at least if I believe in this model should somehow be also correctly reproduced up here.
Back to the original model, you can compute
that. These things you can compute, yeah, and we'll have exactly the same form. That's right. And then absolutely. That's right. Absolutely. I mean, so yes. No, no, if I take the Gibbs measure, yeah, that's
so
what I mean.
Gibbs measure, for example, depends on a temperature.
No, no, that's right. I mean, this is the Gibbs measure, and then this will be actually Kovac relations, yes. These are actually theorems.
So C will be
the integral over the two-point function. Absolutely. These are really theorems. I mean, because you see, you can do this. You see here, I'm just integrating over x. And so these correlation functions are decaying exponentially, and these are actually theorems. Okay? I mean, the long time behavior, of course, you know, but, you know, here it's just, this t sort of just comes from the conservation law, so it's a trivial. Okay? All right, so now let's see what we can do next. Okay, so now comes sort of the Well, because you know that the equilibrium measure has exponential decay. Now, if people sort of is, you know, we're always looking at the fluid case. The microscopic model, right? I mean, okay. And if you give, you know, if you take me some stochastic lattice gas, I mean, somehow I have to, you know, also prove something of that type. Yeah. Okay, now comes sort of, fairly obvious, but nevertheless sort of, you know, to my taste, important step. Namely, what you want to go is you want to go to what is usually called normal modes. And the main observation is that when you look at this A term, that's now an n by n matrix. And so, of course, you know, it will sort of make a linear translation, but you know, it sort of mixes the modes still, I mean, because it's not diagonal. And so basically you want to do a transformation that this term becomes diagonal. No, it's just linear algebra. No, nothing very deep. I mean, but the point is, it's sort of, in order to understand what's going on, I mean, that's a very, very crucial step. Okay, and so here what I'm doing. So here I take, so R, it just acts on the components, right? I mean, you know, U is a function of whatever X and T, but R acts only on the components. Okay.
So R is just some
3 by n matrix. Okay, given n by n matrix. And these are the original, let's say, physical fields, and these are the normal fields. So it's just a linear transformation, and this R matrix is uniquely defined by requiring, first of all, that it should diagonalize the C. So you see, you have the C1 up to Cn. These are just the eigenvalues of A, and they are real. And the other thing is that I simply impose the phi phi correlations in the stationary measure should be just sort of the unit matrix, right? I mean, that's sort of a way of to normalize this phi. It's a linear transformation. Of course, there's some freedom how to do that, okay? All right, and now, of course, you can rewrite the whole system into these normal modes. Of course, it doesn't change very much. I mean, you know, you still have the quadratic term with some new coefficients which you can compute, and you still have the dissipative and the fluctuating term. But now these modes, sort of each one of them has a definite sort of definite speed or definite velocity, okay? All right. Now, okay, so this is sort of what I like to call the multi-component KPC, okay? All right, and what you can check, I mean, so I checked this and Funaki gives talks where he claims that he can actually sort of make proof out of it. I mean, that's maybe still something missing, but anyway, I think that sort of seems to be a pretty correct statement. You can ask yourself, what about the invariant measures? And it's a usual game. I mean, you look at the invariant measures with the Gaussian part, and you hope that adding this quadratic term doesn't mess up things, which, of course, is a, you know, maybe too much of a hope. But in fact, the answer is yes. But there is a condition. I mean, for the Burgers equation, it's always true. But here, there's a condition. I mean, so these G matrices, by construction, because they're Hessians, are symmetric matrices in the lower indices, I mean, which corresponds to the phi. So this is a trivial identity. But you also need that if I interchange them sort of between components. And of course, that's a real constraint. I mean, you know, I can easily write down carbons and G matrices for which this is violated. But if this condition is satisfied, then spatial white noise is actually an invariant measure. And then all the other things which I was talking about is sort of actually, at least, you know, the sum rules and all these things have sort of come out perfectly correct. Now, if this is violated, I mean, we simply don't know anything about invariant measures. Okay, so now comes sort of the physical insight, which of course is a claim. I mean, it would be nice if one could sort of understand this more deeply, but I mean, let me sort of, and I will give you first a rather poor explanation, but later on, maybe if I have time, there will be a little bit better explanation, but let me just first say this, okay? So now comes sort of this observation of what I call the decoupling mechanism, and let's concentrate on mode one. I mean, so this is the one mode. And let's assume that it has a velocity which is different from all the other modes. Well, so I've just written this down. I mean, so symbolically, I mean, so this is sort of the important term. And then now I have here kept all these nonlinear terms. And of course, there are many more other terms over here. And there's a dissipation and noise. But then you look at this, and then you say, ah, you know, that's interesting. This, you know, I mean, the phi 2 mode should travel with a velocity c2, which is, by assumption, different from c1. So this, and if, you know, of course, you know, these things are, I mean, these are all sort of, you know, solutions of stochastic equations, so they are not really localized, right? But anyway, so you somehow believe that maybe this term doesn't give any important contribution. And similarly, you can argue over here, I mean, you know, this phi 2 will sort of travel also with a velocity which is c2 minus c1. And so somehow you argue that this term and this term actually sort of are small, right? Now, of course, well, because phi 2 is simply, well, I mean, c1 is traveling with velocity c1, and c2 is traveling with velocity c2. Since I'm sitting on c1, right, then, you know, this is sort of, okay. And so, you know, I'm looking at the space time point where this sort of makes substantial changes, and then this will be sort of far away. Essentially, they don't interact, yeah. Okay. No, I'm completely.
At speeds,
yeah, basically, I'm trying to say that eventually they will. I mean, of course, you know, it's a sort of asymptotic result. It just go. Yeah, that's right. I mean, so that's another way to say it. Well, I mean, if you believe this, then of course you see that, you know, you're just reduced to the one component case, and so the conclusion is the following: so mode one decouples if. And that's, of course, an important if, because, you know, it could very well be that this coefficient happens to be zero. I mean, that's sort of, at the moment, not at all excluded. But if this happens to be non-zero, then you would think that and of course, if the velocities are distinct, then you would hope that you should see the standard standard KPC scaling.
So who decides whether phi 1 is a left or a right chiral mode?
Well, it's this, no, the C1s, no, the velocity.
Look at the last equation.
Yeah, sure.
The argument x minus C1.
T, yeah.
Why not x plus C1?
Well, because here there's a plus sign here. You know, these are the eigenvalues of the linearized thing. I mean, they fix for me the velocities. So I have the microscopic.
I'd like to understand the physics now.
Okay,
so.
Sure, yes, sure.
And they don't couple on.
Yeah, that's right. No, it's not so obvious. I'm not saying it's obvious, but that's sort of one basic mechanism which we believe sort of is in action. Now, of course, it's only true after long times, right? I mean, for intermediate times, of course, the left and right movers will interact, right? But you know, if I wait long enough, and if I wait even longer, then eventually you would hope that you know it actually goes to this particular type of scaling function. All right. Okay. All right. So now let's do two applications, and then if I have time, we can come back to the theory. I mean, sort of just wants to convince you that it's not completely empty. And so one thing which I did together with Patrick and Tomohiro was to say, well, let's look at a simple stochastic model where you would think, you know, these things should come out, you know, very well, because, you know, then there's not this issue of whether it's sufficiently chaotic. I mean, it's a stochastic system, and you can sort of check many things. I mean, you know, you can check that there are no other conservation laws and all these type of things. So lots of complications which are present for the mechanical systems are no longer there. But it's the same philosophy, you see. I mean, on short times, it will do something very complicated, but eventually it will be sort of the hydrodynamic picture which takes over. And so the model which we picked is a model in the literature, which is a model devised by Arndt Heitzel and Rittenberg. I mean, that's why it's called AHR model. And so you see, it's very similar to the type of models which we have seen over the last 3 months. I mean, so I have right and left movers. So here are the, so first of all, I have this exclusion rule. So at each side, I can have either a right or left mover. And the right movers are moving to the right with rate 1. I mean, always conditioned on the exclusion. And the left movers are moving to the left. And so the only thing which I have to tell you is how they do actually this interchange, right? I mean, so they're next to each other, you know, I have to say what they do. And the rule what Arndt Heitzel Rittenberg said, well, I mean, let's simply assume that they exchange. I mean, the reverse is forbidden, and they do this with weight R, and weight R will be one parameter in my model, okay? And you can see that this has two conserved quantities trivially. I mean, the plus and minuses, the right and left movers, there are two densities. And because we have the exclusion rule, I mean, you know, the parameter of the density space is this rho 1 and rho 2. And I guess the simulation which I'm going to show you is sort of somewhere here in the middle where the densities are actually equal. Okay. Now, the next thing what you want to do for this model, in order to do the hydrodynamic theory, you have to know the steady states. And you have to compute the covariance. Now, this is a non-trivial thing. I mean, these are not product measures for this case, except for a very special value of r, which happens to be equal to 2. But otherwise, they are not product states. Nevertheless, you can still compute the invariant measures. I mean, this is something which Tomohiro did many years ago. You have to use this famous matrix product ansatz of Derrida and sort of also used for quantum spin chains. And out of this, you can actually compute the invariant measures. And you can compute all these matrices, in this case, 2x2 matrices, directly from your microscopic model. So the C, the R, the A, the G, they are all given. Right? Okay. Of course, they depend on the value of the rows. They depend on the value of R, but they are given for us. Okay. And now you can do this normal mode transformation. These are the occupation variables for the right and left movers. And now I just do a simple linear transformation, which gives me, you know, these normal modes phi 1 and phi 2. And then the quantity which you compute is simply, you know, numerically this covariance of the normal modes. I mean, I have to truncate, and this of course is done in the stationary process with fixed density rho plus and rho minus. Okay, that's all what you do.
So wait a minute. So you don't have the invariant measures.
Well, in this case, we do have the invariant measures through the matrix product ansatz, but they are not product. That's what I'm trying to say. They are more complicated. I mean, you cannot write it as a Gibbs measure. You have to.
How can you write it?
As a matrix product. I mean, basically, what you do is you know, if you take a finite system on a ring, I mean, to every possible local configuration, you associate a matrix, and then you see that in order to get the steady state, I mean, you get a certain matrix algebra which you have to solve. And you know, have to use representation of this matrix algebra, and from this you can actually compute sort of various physical quantities. I mean, various expectations. Okay, so it's a.
It isn't beta ansatz.
No, it's not beta ansatz. I mean, at least not to my understanding. It's sort of different. Okay, so what is the prediction? I mean, just to make sure that we see what I'm doing. So I mean, the prediction is that you know, this decoupling means that this correlation matrix should be diagonal for long times. Of course, it's sort of at time t equals 0, it's certainly not diagonal. I mean, we'll have off-diagonal elements. And in fact, it will be sort of augmented in time. And then, of course, you have our standard KPC scaling function. Here, I guess I should have put it up here. I mean, here I'm putting for you what the G matrix look like. Of course, these are some numbers. I mean, but I just put ones in order to make you see the structure. So important point is these two ones, I mean, ensure you that you should have KPC scaling. This zero is actually another important thing because it tells you that the subleading corrections are very small. Okay, that's I haven't explained, but I mean, the point is that this zero is actually very crucial. And then, but you still have couplings because you still have these off-diagonal elements over here. And so what do I see in my simulation? Well, I start at time t equals 0, so you know, it's very short-range correlated, so you have sort of like a peak of two modes which are both located at the 0. As time goes on, they simply separate and they broaden. And since we are sitting on a circle of 400 sites, I mean, this is what I've written over here, you know, eventually, of course, they will collide, and then sort of more complicated things are going on. Okay, so that's all what you see, okay? And of course, the point is that you know, we can compute everything. I mean, we know the velocities. We also know how these things are spreading. We know the shape. All these things sort of in principle is sitting up here, right? And we know the lambda alphas. Everything is there. Okay, so let's have a look what the simulation is. So this is, I mean, just for short times. I mean, it tells you, so here you see, I mean, 400 is equal to 0. So here you see these two peaks sort of hardly separating. But we also plotted the off-diagonal elements to show you that you get correlations which go beyond the static correlation. There's extra dynamic correlations which are built up. But you can see from this already that, you know, the off-diagonal elements are actually pretty small. And so later on, I just don't plot the off-diagonal element anymore. Right? I just plot the two diagonal elements. All right. So here you see, I mean, so that's the initial time. And now it's a rather sort of, you know, boring picture. I mean, here you see how the two modes are propagating. And so this is propagating this way, this is propagating this way, and now we run up to this long time, they start already intersecting, okay? But the main point is that, you know, this curve, I mean, these ones are fitted by this KPC scaling curve, and it's a perfect fit. I mean, there's no free parameter in this model. So let's see. This is, I guess, for one particular value of this R parameter. I mean, there's another value of this R parameter where things look like this. I mean, so this is a somewhat different parameter. You have sort of a little bit less noise, and these objects. I mean, of course, here you still see some deformation, but once you are here, I mean, this is sort of a perfect fit. I mean, you can maybe cannot see it here, but it's sort of superimposed. It's a perfect fit to the KPC scaling function. Well, the R parameter was this rate of interchange of the. So as I change R, so you're changing the invariant measure, and the density we kept in the simulation fixed, right? I mean, so just to have two values that you see that it's not so bad, okay?
In the D1, they started to intersect each other.
Yeah, yeah, sure. That's sort of, of course, this is sort of. Well, it is surprisingly good. In fact, I mean, we simulated also beyond the collision, and after they sort of escape from the collision, they sort of still reappear with KPC scaling, but with a different lambda. Okay, so, okay, you can clearly the theory does not cover that case at all at the moment, at least, right? In fact. You should be very suspicious because, you know, it works too well. But the reason why it works so well is because the theoretical reason why it works so well is because of this zero. If this zero we would replace by one, I mean, then it would be just totally different, right? I mean, okay. All right. So now I want to sort of come back to sort of these anharmonic chains. And okay, so let me sort of use sort of last few minutes, I mean, to explain you how we apply this to anharmonic chains. So I'm looking now at these chains. I mean, it's only, you know, particles with neighboring index which are interacting through a potential. And somehow you want to have this potential going up. So what I want to have a parameter. So this is my potential here. Inverse temperature is positive, strictly positive. And this is the pressure. And somehow I want to make sure that there's a non-empty set of pressures for which this is well defined. So at least, you know, on one side, you have sort of potential mass increase, sort of like exponentially. Okay. All right. Now here you have the three conserved fields. I mean, you have difference in positions. That's the elongation. You have the momentum. You have the local energy. And you see that these quantities are all one-body quantities, and therefore the equilibrium measures are simply product measures. And the equilibrium parameters. I mean, I always work at total momentum equal to zero. The equilibrium parameters is the energy per side and the elongation per site. And the grand canonical variables are the beta and the p. And so you see that you can compute all these coefficients over here, right? I mean, it's just basically doing sort of moments of this simple integral, and that the computer does for you for free, right? I mean, so of course, you know, in a concrete case, somebody gives us a potential. We have to go through this algebra, but this you certainly don't want to do by hand. But of course, you know, you can compute all these quantities. Yes?
Yes. So, I mean, are you now forgetting space?
No. The chain or the index. It's a lattice field theory.
Yes. So let's see.
Because you're in one dimension, I guess.
One dimension, sure. It's a one-dimensional lattice. It's a one-dimensional lattice. It's a chain, yeah. Yes, it's a one-dimensional. It's a one-dimensional index. Yeah, we are here. Well, first you have to compute the conservation laws, right? I mean, so you take ddt of rj, and you find that it's pj plus 1 minus pj, and so you know that the carbon for the r variables is the momentum.
Yeah.
And then you just keep going. I mean, okay, you do the same computation for the p, and you do the computation for e, and then you find what are your currents, right? So now at every side you have a current. I mean, I can write down for you the formula, but then we will sort of not anywhere come to the end, right? I mean, so what I'm saying is that you have currents, right? I mean, so let me not try to reproduce them by heart. I mean, it will be more confusing. It's just like doing exactly the same computation for the others, and you see that they have the type of a conservation law on the lattice, and therefore by your now you do the average value over the equilibrium measure. Okay, these are all one-body quantities.
You do that numerically.
No. It's one-dimensional integral, right? Of course, you know, if I give you a complicated potential, I just do it numerically, right? I mean, If you do, you know.
You see, the trick is that only neighboring particles appear to interact with each other.
That is the chain. Yeah, that's the chain. Yeah. Exactly, just change of variable. Okay, so what I'm saying is that everything is reduced to looking at basically at I mean, if I want to do all these things, you have to look at up to third order cumulus of that measure. That's all.
Yes.
Okay, that of course you do numerically, right? I mean, because
there's no MD simulation that's needed for this.
No. This we can still do directly for. Okay, and so what I'm saying is that these covariance, you know, as a function of the equilibrium parameters, right? I mean, so that you know them as a function of U. That's doing this equilibrium averages. So then I can compute, the linear-wise and the quadratic terms of these covariance. Okay? And of course, I can sort of look at the eigenvalues of the A, and I can compute the C's. That's all. Okay? No, it's specifically a simple system. I mean, not. No.
Yes, at the beginning you had the gas.
Yeah, but I can do, but you know, I mean, if I take the hard point gas, you see, if I take the hard point gas, I mean, which I mentioned, so you have these two types of particles, of course, you know, it falls exactly into this thing. The only thing is that the unit cell consists of two particles, and that's it. I mean,
You neglect the interactions.
There aren't any for that particular model.
Oh, I mean,
yeah, sure. I mean, yeah, you can look at more complicated. I'm sure you can look at more complicated things. I mean, but you know, the theory would also apply to these other cases for the real one-dimensional fluids. But then, of course, computing these coefficients would be a little bit more
difficult,
more labor. And well, I mean, yeah, maybe do it numerically. I mean, it's, you know, certainly available. I mean, it's not a big deal. I mean, that's not the problem. Okay. So now, what we find, of course, is that we have the two sound modes which move with velocity plus E and minus E, and we have also the central mode which is sitting exactly at the origin, and this is usually called the heat mode. Okay, so that's the result, and that's of course the same thing as what you would see for three-dimensional fluids. I mean, there's no difference at that stage. Okay, and now you look at these coefficients and you find that the dominant coefficients for the two sound modes, the G11 and the G-1 -1 -1 -1 are actually really, I mean, except I take very special potentials like a harmonic chain or so, for which, of course, things, you know, are just linear, so that these coefficients are really zero, but they are generically non-zero, and therefore we can apply the decoupling argument.
So what is S thing up there?
So S is now, is okay, so what I plotted here is now, okay, so S is a 3x3 matrix. It's a sort of space-time correlation of the conserved quantities. And in order to make it scalar, I simply, to the right and to the left, I multiply, so take scalar product with a three-dimensional vector. So here you have a scalar quantity, but what this scalar quantity will do is just will change, you know, the linear combination of the three modes which I'm going to see.
What's the S made of? It's made of these, it's just 3x3
matrix made out of the conserved quantities. Right?
The,
I mean,
expectation.
Yeah, sure, always the expectation.
You didn't define that. Did you define that in a previous slide?
So I didn't write it down. I mean, so I take these three conserved quantities and I form its time correlation, which gives you a 3x3 matrix, right? And so now I'm plotting this, but now how do I plot the 3x3 matrix? I say that you know, I can take here the scalar product, and depending on how I choose this vector chi, I will see particular linear combination of these three modes, right? I mean, that's all what I'm saying, right? We'll always look like this, okay? And if I fix the chi in such a way that I pick a normal mode, then I will see only one single peak. I mean, that's how the normal modes are defined, right? I mean, so, but it's just simple linear transformation, right? Nothing deep. Okay, so but there's one important conclusion, namely when you look at these two sound modes, I mean, then you will see actually KPC. I mean, you will not see KPC. I mean, you will see that you know, this coefficient is always non-zero, and then if you apply the decoupling argument, you would expect for the sound modes to see KPC behavior. However, if you look at the sound mode, then you find that no matter how you pick the potential, this coefficient will be always zero, and therefore the sound mode cannot be KPC, because you know the leading term is actually vanishing, and so you have to go back to the theory in order to understand what's going on. This is the heat mode. I mean, the one which is standing still. You see, we have three eigenvalues, plus C, minus C, and zero. Okay, so there's one mode which is standing still, which is usually called the heat mode. And then there are these two modes which are propagating out.
So how will a heat mode be described then? Is that described by KPG?
Okay, that's coming, yeah. But I mean, so I think what I want to emphasize is that this is something which you cannot see by looking at the original version. You can only see when you go to the normal modes. Yes?
So why is it not possible that there's some dispersion in a nonlinear change?
Sure, there is dispersion. That's what I'm trying to tell you all the time.
Yeah,
and then they then I'm telling you how they disperse. I mean, they disperse like t to the 2/3. I mean, this was.
No, but is it dispersion in the sense that the velocity, there's a whole range of different propagation velocities?
Well, hydrodynamics tells you otherwise. It just isn't.
But do we understand that starting is a nonlinear chain, right? It's like that.
Well, understanding is sort of, it's always a difficult word. I mean, I think we understand. My answer would be yes, because, I believe that the Euler equations, even for one-dimensional chain, should be not such a bad description. Now, of course, we know that there will be examples. You know, there are integrable systems for which this is presumably not a very good, but, these are just sort of, sort of exceptions. But generically, I would think the Euler equations for one-dimensional chain should be okay. Now, if you believe that, then this is a consequence. No, I'm not saying it. I'm certainly not claiming that all systems are like that, right? I mean, there could be. We have to really look at the details. But if I decide to look at these FPU chains, I mean, it will be okay. Okay, so let me see. So now you see that if you want to do the heat mode, I mean, we have to go beyond the decoupling, and so we have to sort of. And of course, in principle, if you want to compare with numerical things, you should look at the finite time convections to the predictions which come from the KPC. So, and these convections are actually usually not small. And okay. So now let's see. So I guess my time is sort of running out. I mean, so I think I would love to explain this, but maybe I just skip this actually. So this is sort of a slightly more sophisticated theory. So far we haven't done really much theory, right? All what I told you is I wrote down equations and I told you the decoupling, okay? So this is now the more sophisticated theory. So I do a one-loop approximation. It's just sort of a standard stochastic field theory. That's the simplest approximation you could do. And the second thing, which sort of seems to be true in all the cases which we studied, is that you do a diagonal approximation. And then you write down nonlinear equations for these functions f, which are of this particular type. You can analyze them. And if you do this, you get actual predictions. And so this is what I wanted to show you, is that when you sort of now do this sort of more sophisticated type theory, what you find that if I look at the shape function for the heat mode, it will be actually, in momentum space, it looks like this. And in position space, it will be actually the Levy 5/3 distribution. Okay, that comes out of this sort of doing the convections properly. So I would love to explain you how you do this computation. Again, it's a very simple, straightforward computation, right? I mean, of course, it's based on the approximation of one loop and this diagonal approximation. And so, we would not assert this, let's say, with the same security as I would assert the KPC scaling for the sound modes. But at least, it must be something which is sort of going in this direction. Okay. And so, in order to convince you, I want to show you sort of some. This is work in progress by Abhishek Dar, and presumably by now he has even better things. I mean, so what he did is he simulated an FPU chain with 4,000 sites. What you will see are data for two different times. I mean, one which is sort of approximately 1,500, and the other one which is approximately 800. Okay, and the time of collision is sort of like somewhat later than that. I mean, if you want to really go up to the collision time, if you look at the sound speed, it's sort of more like 2,000. So he's before actually having the collision. Okay. So here are this figure. So here, first of all, these are the other sound modes, and so you see here the moving with velocity c here, and there are only two data, which you can hardly see. I mean, there's the red curve and there's the blue curve, but there are two very different times. So it simply checks whether there's the scaling in t, and what you see is sort of something which should be close to the KPC scaling curve. Now, as I said, these are the raw data, and we have to wait for a little while I mean, Abhishek is going.
This is not the heat curve.
Hmm?
This is not the heat mode.
That's not the heat mode. So he this is the KPC scaling, and he just put some other exponent, and then he sees that sort of you see deviations right. I mean, so it's not yet on the level of, you know, highest precision, but you know things are going to come. I guess Abhishek is going to visit in end of January, and I'm sure that you know he will have sort of more precise data. But what I wanted to show you is sort of one thing, one prediction is that. You know, when this is now the heat mode, right? And he does exactly the same thing. I mean, the theoretical prediction would be 0.6. And here he simply checks with two other things. So let's simply assume that, you know, this is a curve. But what you can see is that, you know, I mean, this is really in X space. And in X space, you will have a power law decay. Because in K space, you have this singularity like, you know, K absolute value. And so the 5/3. And therefore, you know, you see actually sort of rather slow tails here. And that you can sort of see with your naked eye already, that you know these curves sort of do not really have the same sort of fast decay. This one should decay like sort of, you know, I mean, faster than exponential actually, right? I mean, so I'm not saying that this proves anything. I just want to say that you know, it's already a big achievement. You see, in here, I mean, the difficulty is that, you know, you need a large simulation. You need sufficiently large time in order to see this. And so, you know, the qualitative picture sort of goes in the direction which I was trying to explain.
So, what are we supposed to learn from this biometric?
Well, I guess what we are supposed to learn is that if you put sort of theoretical predicted scaling exponent 0.6, it fits better than the two other ones.
I can't tell the difference
between the
first two.
Well, okay. I mean, well, yeah. No, I think it's.
Well,
I mean, you know, let's forget about this one. No, I mean, you know, I'm not saying that it's you know, but if you put the square root, I mean, then you see that, you know, that, I mean, certainly you don't have good scaling, right? I mean, so. No, I mean, you know, there must be more data in order to get to the type of precision which I'm sort of imagining. But you know, just to tell you also that you know, it's a non-trivial exercise, even if you're prepared to do sort of molecular dynamics. If you go back to real space, I mean, then you will get, you know, yeah, that's the scaling it should have. Okay.
And that comes from mode coupling.
That comes from this prediction comes from doing the mode coupling. So you need the one loop approximation and sort of the less serious sort of diagonal approximation, but it's clearly approximation, right? I mean, because mode coupling certainly, you know, I mean, mode coupling will not get the exact KPC scaling function, right? I mean, so it's an approximation. I mean, and so.
Once you do the
Yeah, that's right. And of course we don't know, right? And then of course, okay. But I mean, once you believe the mode coupling equation, I mean, this is actually a sort of, I mean, it's a more or less direct consequence. But you know, even there, I mean, you know, for instance, in order to derive this, you assume already that the sound modes sort of have KPC scaling and all this type of things. And so you know, it's sort of this mixed argument, All right, so let's see. So I guess we're at the end. So let me just say that, I mean, we have done numerical simulations of the mode coupling, which are actually very instructive. I mean, that's work with Christian Mendel. There's FISREF letter where you can read these things. And then, of course, I mean, as you can see from the previous slide, I mean, what we really need in order to check whether the theory, you know, I mean, this sort of multi-component KPC theory is actually a valid theory. I mean, we definitely need more detailed comparisons with molecular dynamics, which, however, are in the way. I mean, so I think within 1 year we will have sort of a more clear picture, you know, whether this theory is actually valid. Okay, so thank you very much.